find a seat or no, or it's not going to work or whatever. Yeah, that's good, that's good, that's good. I'm going to pray first and we'll ask God's blessing on the day. Does that work?
Yes, sir.
All right. Dear God, thank you for the opportunity to serve you in this way and also to proclaim you in this way. And I thank you for those that today are taking this step in their lives that will signal something to us all as well as to you that there's been a change. And I pray that you'll be in control of what we do and say here today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So let me just give you a little bit of background here quick and sort of set this up. In the book of Acts, chapter 8, there's a guy named Philip, and he was one of the Spirit-filled ministers of the Day of Pentecost result. And he was instructed by God to go join himself to a chariot where there was a guy from Ethiopia that was riding along in the chariot. And the guy in the chariot needed some help. Anybody ever need any help?
Yes.
Here's this guy trying to figure out how it all works. So he's reading in the Old Testament. He's reading from the prophet Isaiah. And Isaiah 53. And it talks about he was wounded for our transgressions. And he was bruised for our iniquity. And the chastisement of our peace is upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. He's reading that. And he can't figure out who's being talked about here. So he asked the Ethiopian guy, asked Philip, he said, is this guy talking about himself or somebody else? Well, it happened to be a messianic prophecy regarding the Messiah, Jesus, that would come. And so he's trying to figure out this whole experience. So the Ethiopian guy probably came from Jerusalem and heading down to Egypt. And he was in a caravan, and he no doubt got a Bible out of the Holiday Inn. The Gideon's left, I think, in one of the drawers when he was there. And just trying to figure out, how does this whole thing work? And I'm confused by it all. How does it work? And apparently he, too, was looking for the Messiah. And so he said, regarding what had been taking place in Jerusalem, he said, you know, I know they're baptizing a lot of folks there. He says, here's water. What hinders me to be baptized? Which is really cool. It's one of those point blank questions regarding the topic of baptism. What do I have to do to be baptized? What's required? And so, and it says in Acts chapter 8 that they came to a certain water. Well, I like that because when the Bible needs to be specific, it gets specific. When it needs to be vague, it gets vague. And if it had said the Jordan River, then man, we'd all be heading over there to get baptized. We couldn't do it in Eddie's pool. And but it was just water. What about the water? I don't know. Was it clean? Probably not. Was it healthy? I don't know. Was it how much water was there? I don't know, except that I know that in a minute it says that they both went down into the water. So it's enough water to hold two people. That's what I know. And so the question came, what's the requirement? And the requirement came from Philip saying this, if you believe with all your heart, you may. Now I gotta say something about that, because we have in the Western world, we have sort of a cheap kind of belief. Oh yeah, I believe that all my life. Oh yeah, I grew up in America. Everybody believes in Jesus. I mean, after all, don't we have Easter Bunny? And don't we have Santa Claus? We all believe in Jesus, right? So it's not a casual thing. He said, if you believe with all your heart. So that becomes the requirement then for a person to get baptized. You got to have this heartfelt belief. An act of God takes place, a change takes place. God comes and actually lives in you at that moment. This is not cheap. This is something that's done extremely deliberately out of a very sincere heart. And so the man came along and said, with that thought in mind, I believe Jesus is the Son of God. Well, that's quite a declaration. Now, in our country, it's easy to say that because we're kind of accustomed to being around it. In other countries, not so much. In other countries, I spend some time over in North Africa, and I teach in a seminary, an underground seminary for Muslim converts. Well, when they make that statement, oh man, it means something. I believe Jesus is the Son. Well, that's like a lightning bolt to them. And I think that lightning bolt's kind of required for all of us. And I don't mean there's going to be lightning, but I mean when we bow our head and we ask the Lord to come into our lives and we tell Him, I believe. We're looking for something to change. We're looking for something in our lives. On the day of Pentecost, when they believed in Jesus, that's what the problem was, the sticking point was, is this the Messiah or not? And when they finally got convinced that this is indeed the Messiah, then they believed. And the Bible says that day 3,000 people. That's a lot. And what was it? Well, it was going from, I'm following Moses and the law of Moses, I'm following the Old Testament, I'm following the ceremony, I'm doing all the things that we're supposed to do religiously. But now, there's going to be a change here, and the change is going to be, I'm going to follow Jesus. So, that's a big, giant step for a person even that's been religious. Change from religion and say, I'm going to follow Jesus. So what we do at the Salvation Army, and some of you guys here are from the Salvation Army today, and we're going to commit you to this baptism today, and some of the guys from vocational church and others and family members and like. And so here's what we all do at one point in our lives. We all bow our heads and we say, Lord, I'm in. We all say out of a sincere heart, this is for me. We all say, I'm making this decision in my life. It's a big deal. It's life-changing if you do it with a sincere heart. Reciting prayers, yeah, it's kind of boring. But meaning them in your heart, that's life-changing. So here's what we're going to do just to be sure. I have no idea where everybody is at the spiritual level. So I'm going to lead us all in a prayer that says to the Lord, I'm in. I want you in my life. So let's all bow our heads, and we're going to just go along with this, and I'm going to lead you in a simple prayer. At Salvation Army, we do it right out loud, so I'm in favor of that. So with our heads bowed, and here's what I want you to do. I want you to be as sincere as you can possibly be. I like people to get a picture in their mind's eye of Jesus, because that's who we talk to. So we're going to talk to Him. We're going to tell Him something. And here's what we're going to tell Him. Are you ready? Lord, I know that I'm a sinner.
Lord, I know that I'm a sinner.
And I'm sorry for my sins.
And I'm sorry for my sins.
And the best I know how.
And the best I know how.
I accept Jesus as my Savior.
I accept Jesus as my Savior.
I know I can't save myself.
I know I can't save myself.
I'm trusting Jesus to save me.
So I'm trusting Jesus to save me.
I need you in my life.
I need you in my life.
I need you in my heart.
I need you in my heart.
I need you in my home.
I need you in my home.
And today I commit myself to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Now, I have no way of knowing what goes on in your heart. I wish I could tell. Someday, maybe it's better off I don't know. All I know is we're trying to do our part. We're trying to make people aware and get the spiritual connection that we make. And for those of you who want to follow the Lord in baptism today, it always follows that decision. It's a signal to God. You got it. And that's a good signal. Now, just by mechanics, here's how we're going to do this. when you, I'm going to get in this water in a minute. I know, I'm sorry for my legs that are so wide. If they're blinding you,
try to look away. Yeah.
But here's what I want you to do. I want you to take your hand and put it on your wrist like that. And then when it's time, I want you to hold your own nose. And that'll give me something to hang on to. And your nose will be flushed. You got it? So this is simple. You do that, and you do that, and I'm going to say, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. And then I'm going to say, buried in the likeness of his death, because we're depicting the death of Jesus. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. And that's it. So that's what we're going to do. And Brian's eager, so you're first. Brian's eager. Here we go. So now we got to figure out.
You going to say my brother even if it's a woman?
Maybe. Same thing.
I haven't had the surgery, no. Let me find a good spot for Brian. Baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Buried in the likeness of his death. Praise to God.
I'd bring a towel.
I did.
That was a load, by the way, Brian.
Thank you.
Wow. That's just not right.
Take one to no one.
Face the same way. I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Buried in the likeness of his death. Raised to walk in the
name of the Father. All right.
He's coming. He's doing striptease over there. Who's next? Chris, come on.
Dan's coming now.
All right, come on. Let me help you down here. No. I'm just being polite.
Come on, Ben, you're next.
How are you? I'm not like to get one
more.
Did it yourself.
Hey, can
I get it where you want. All right. I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Buried in the likeness of his death.
Hold your nose. All right.
Baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Buried in the likeness of his death. Baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Buried in the likeness of his death.
All right.
Thank you. As you my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of his death.
All right.
Baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. Baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Buried in the likeness of his death, so he did. Save the easiest for the
Chris,
last.
You getting in there?
Yeah.
Baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Buried in the likeness of his death. Raised to walk in newness of life. Amen.
No.
Chris.
Chris. Oh, come on, Chris.
Just go in. What are you waiting for? Come on.
You in?
Flip-flops and all, huh?
Down the stairs. Yeah, I forgot. It's okay. They get every inch of them, huh?
What? That was Andy.
Baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Buried in the likeness of his death. Raised to walk in the
All right.
Oh, man. I need a helper.
Need a helper?
No.
All right, man.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, hey, there we go. All right.
Yeah, right. Need to get back deeper.
Getting deeper water.
It's a tough crowd.
Yeah.
I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah,
wait a minute. I'll show you. Okay. Buried in the likeness of his death. Raised to walk in newness of life.
Amen.
Is that it? Eddie?
No, I've done enough.
Too late?
Too
late for Eddie. All right, let me pray.
Yes, please.
Now, dear God, bless us now, and thank you for these people have made this decision in their life. Mm-hmm. And Lord, I thank you for this moment that they can look back to and say, that's the day that I signaled my intention to follow Jesus.
Yes.
I thank you for the food we're about to eat, and I pray that you'll bless us as we do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
And Eddie, tell them what to do about changing clothes.